We are now ready to welcome Javed Akhtar. Once he is free of fans, and Zoya Akhtar in conversation with Jai Arjun Singh on the changing protagonists of Hindi cinema. This is a Vivel special session.
Thanks. Is the sound audible? Okay, just let us know if there's any problem with the acoustics, please. Thanks. Just wanted to say first, it's a great privilege to be doing this, because of the quality of the work associated with these two artists here on stage. With Javed Saab, of course, in addition to all his other literary accomplishments, what he did for Hindi cinema in starting with the early 70s. Speaking for myself, like so many others of my generation, I grew up with my favorite audio cassette being the double audio cassette of Sholay's dialogues, which was such an unusual thing in that time to have a cassette release like that, where the songs were just played for 10 or 15 seconds, but the dialogues of the film were what mattered. And that was the Saleem Javed moment in Hindi cinema. And with Zoya, her debut film, Luck by Chance, is one of my two or three favorite Hindi movies of the last 10 years. I think it's such a masterfully realized insider's view of the film industry. It could have been a really self-indulgent project done by a second generation film person bringing together all her friends and doing an incestuous little thing, but it was a really mature and self-possessed film that said so many interesting things about the Hindi film industry and was sympathetic and pointed at the same time. And her subsequent films, Dil Dhadakne Do in particular, I've also been a great fan of. I'm sure many of you here are huge fans of their work as well. I wanted to start, since we're talking about the changing protagonist of Hindi cinema, I thought perhaps we could look at the heroes and heroines associated with Javed Saab's work in the 70s vis-a-vis Zoya's work in recent years. So to begin with, Javed Saab, when you helped create the figure of the angry young man in the early 70s. It was a time in Hindi cinema when the heroes were mostly romantic. We had had the Shami Kapoor moment. We had had the Rajesh Khanna phenomenon. What was it about that time, about the social climate of the time, that made you and Saleem Saab feel like the time was ripe for a vigilante figure like that to come in as a hero?
Well, I can sound extremely wise in retrospective. Everybody has a 2020 view. But the fact is that when we did, we were not at all conscious, or we are aware that we are in sync with the society. This is the mood of the society, so we should write these kind of scripts. There was nothing as objective or as calculated as that. These are the stories that inspired us. These were the stories that we thought are interesting, worth telling. And we were young and cocky enough to believe that so what, everybody is making romantic films. These are better stories. And we could be wrong also in that confidence. But fortunately, we were right. So now when we look back and we talk about it, and so much have been written about those films, this was the socio-economic or socio-political atmosphere that made this actor, this character, angry young man, relevant and acceptable and representative of a common man's mood and so on. But we were not aware of it. But doesn't matter, this is about us. What is important, that obviously at any given point of time, we must start from the point that what is the definition of a protagonist, whether a male or female? A protagonist, I suppose, is the personification of contemporary morality and contemporary aspirations. With time, morality changes. With time, aspirations change. So the protagonist also changes, that image of protagonist. This was the mood, this was the morality and the aspiration of that time. We were the part of the time, And that is why we like that. Not that we thought that this is the time and that is what we should do. We were within that ethos. We were inhaling the same air that the rest of the society was. And we were on the, fortunately, we were on the same page. So our choice, our aesthetics, our liking, our morality or inspiration was somehow was in sync with most of the people. That is why it worked.
Javed Saab, it's interesting that you say that the 70s was, you know, there was a time of aspiration, because one thing that strikes me is that when you look at the really seminal films like Diwar, you know, the Amitabh Bachchan's Vijay is of course a sympathetic anti-hero in many ways, but you also know as he's making that symbolic climb from the footpath to the top of the skyscraper, you also know that he's going to have a fall at some point. There will be comeuppance. Those films, it seems to me that the films that you scripted back then were always a little suspicious of the very rich and of, you know, the means of getting rich. Whereas there's something about the post-liberalization cinema of the last, say, 15 years, definitely, where it seems like aspiration is being constantly projected, shown only in good terms. You know, even in films where you have a crook sort of climbing up the social ladder. And I wonder, Zoya, just coming to you, one of the things that you have dealt with, and very unapologetically in your last two films, has been the lifestyles of the very rich and famous. Now, is this something that when you see characters like that in your cinema, is this something that you feel has taken you a long way away from the kinds of films that Javed Saab was scripting in the 70s? Is there a new climate, social climate, that's enabling this sort of cinema?
Yeah, absolutely. Also, there's a different head and a different heart. I mean, I have had a completely different childhood and adolescence and exposure to what he and Salim uncle had. And so where I come from and what my issues are and what the way I see the world and the characters I engage with or identify with and the kind of films and cinema I grew up watching is very different. So, I mean, I can't make movies like them. I mean, even if I tried, I'd fail. Right. I have to do what comes to me naturally. And I keep getting asked this about Dil Dharakne Do, about like it being a lifestyle of the rich and famous. But for me, I don't think it's a rich and famous thing to have disparity between how you bring up your son and daughter.
Right, right.
The gender politics in a family is not about the rich,
right,
in India.
Right.
For your son to take over the business and your daughter to be married and not get divorced,
yeah,
is not something rich people talk about.
Right.
You know, but thematically, people don't want to discuss those themes. So we can talk about money if you want.
Right. Yeah, well, since you touched on that, I have to say I've had this discussion with friends very often. I think one of the most unfair criticisms to be leveled at Dil Dhadakne Do is that old chestnut, who cares about the problems of rich people? I thought that was very unfair because, for one thing, there's something hypocritical about that, because many of the people who were leveling that criticism are people who are very privileged themselves compared to 50-60% of India's population. So it's and of course, as you suggested just now, you know, certain human emotions and human relations are universal. There are, you know, it's not about rich or poor.
No, not just human emotions, certain traits of society, like, yeah, certain things that are very intrinsic to Indian family structure and certain to Indian morality and their understanding of male and female to their gender politics is very Indian, and it's across the board.
Right.
And in fact, I think it's a bit worse in a particular level of society, because they think that they have a lot more to lose.
Because surface yeah, appearances become, yeah, very important.
May I point out one thing? That if somebody says about Dil Dhadakne Do or Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara, that these stories are about rich people, then why don't they have the same objection about most of the TV serials? Because these serials are also about rich people. A clap, come on, clap for that. Thank you. Thank you. I deserve that. You see, all these women are wearing kanjivaram and chiffon sarees, and they are buried under jewelry. Nobody says that this is about rich people. Because the morality is not disturbing them. The morality is accepting the status quo. What is the problem with the film of Zoya film is that there is a challenge to the structure, to challenge to the status quo. There is a questioning of the status quo. That is what disturbs. It is not about the rich people. All these serials are about rich people, and all the poor people look at very comfortably. Nobody bothers.
While on the changing protagonists, and a related point, we were just speaking about the angry young man figure, the swaggering macho figure of the 70s, you know, played by Mr. Bachchan. And now, in your films, for instance, your brother Farhan has his screen image, in any case, is that of the sensitive, new age, somewhat metrosexual man who's, you know, who's who's very aware of things like gender equality, for instance. And in all your work, it feels like the protagonists in your films, and I include also the Ranveer Singh character in Dil Dhadakne Do, have this sensitivity about them, this vulnerability that wasn't quite there in a certain type of hero of the 70s. Would you say that's the case? And again, does that reflect your sensibility as a filmmaker?
Yes and no. I think that there were, I think every decade has had its share of this kind of hero or that kind of hero, or this kind of story, that kind of story, misogyny, sensitivity. I mean, every decade has had that. So there were films made in the 70s also that I identified with, whether it was Sai Pranjpe's films, which were usually male protagonists, Chashme Badur, and they were really, really cool men, or films that had Hrishikesh Mukherjee's films. They weren't like out there, they weren't like really masculine, they were very in touch with their feminine side, they were very in touch. So you have that in every decade. So and now also you have the larger than life, very macho heroes, right, as we speak. So I think in every decade it's the same. It balances itself out. One thing stands out, like in the 90s, the NRI lover boy kind of stood out. But every decade, something maybe is more popular, but it's balanced out, right. I think.
Now, well, you mentioned Sai Pranjpe and Hrishikesh Mukherjee. When I made that comparison, I was talking a little more about what we typically think of as commercial cinema. So, you know, hence Diwar, Trishul, Kalapathar in the 70s, your films, at least your last two films, which would normally be categorized as fairly...
But even their films, like if you... I mean, however I feel masculine their male actors were, I don't think their women were wilting at all, you know? Whether it was their work, or even somebody like Yash Chopra, who I don't think he even thought for one day that he's a feminist. Right. I don't think it ever occurred to him. He just projected women how he saw women. And all his women are very, very strong, very complete, and very actualized characters. Right. So, and they wrote a lot with him. So obviously, he had a part to play in that. So I think it's not just about the, you know, the men can be macho, the women were very strong, they all had careers, they had a point of view, they and they mattered in the story, right. You know, they propelled the story forward, and their perspective and viewpoint was respected. So I think that's what you need. You just need a healthy balance.
You're talking about characters like the characters that Rakhi played in Trishul or in Kalapathar,
exactly.
Or even at another end of the spectrum, the Parveen Babi character in Diwar.
Yeah, but Kalapathar, they were all working women. Parveen Babi was a journalist, Neetu Singh was a peddler, she was selling things, and Rakhi was a doctor. I mean, they all had careers, they had a life that revolved around them, and not just, they weren't just the girlfriend, ever.
Right. For those of you who are at the earlier session that Javed Saab was at today, one of the interesting things you said, Javed Saab, was that you mentioned during the Gaata Rahe Mera Dil session that many of today's filmmakers tend to be a little embarrassed about the older language of Hindi cinema, the song sequences. So many of the more edgy, you know, the more independent writers and filmmakers today will have films where songs play only in the background. You won't have lip syncing. You won't have the hero or the heroine actively singing the song, you know, within the narrative. And there has been that, we will talk about this in a while, but one thing that always strikes me when I look at Zoya's work is that she seems to be much less self-conscious about that. You know, I was watching Dil Dhadakne Do again the other day on TV and marveling, as I so often do, at the Galla Gudiya sequence, which is shot in one take. It's a masterful example of filmmaking, and it hasn't been talked about yet enough. But again, it's also a song where everybody's singing, everybody's actually singing, you know, the film itself is telling us that these guys are singing. And that's something that I find very refreshing in your work. Is that something that because of the films that you grew up watching and loving, you haven't really made that clean break from old Hindi cinema that some of today's directors are making?
I like songs, and I like song and dance if it's done nicely. I needed to weave into the narrative seamlessly. If it's going to work, I'll do it. I won't do it because I have to do it. Like say in Luck by Chance, the film was about the Hindi film industry. So it was very important for me that only the songs that are being picturized to be in a movie should be lip-synced. Right. And the rest of the film, otherwise you can't, you had to create a different real life and real life, which was important, because otherwise it would have seemed fake. So then only those two songs were lip-sync, and the rest were just background music. Or whether it was in Zindagi, how you want to use it, where when you gave them a situation where they get trashed and they're in the middle of a piazza and there is a woman on stage and they go in there and they start singing. So you kind of, you have to create that situation. Or even in Galla Gudiya, where there is a open mic night, because otherwise it jumps at you, you know. So as long as it fits in seamlessly, it's fun to do.
Yeah. One thing at the other song, I've forgotten what the song is called, but the one where Farhan and Priyanka are singing, and it's very interestingly filmed, because you know you just have life going on around them, but they are lip syncing. So obviously it's not really meant to be a realistic thing, but again, was that something that you were trying to reference earlier in this?
Yeah, it was like a music video, like the way I shot it. And for me, it was everything is going on around them, and they are kind of singing to each other, but actually they're not. It's like me in a voice, you know. So it's just play with that. Right. But otherwise, you have to do it creatively.
Zoya, point out something. You see, there is a difference today when you have lip sync in the song. Although I take that point of Luck by Chance totally. I totally agree with you there, because the film was about films. So when you are showing the filming or the shooting, then the lip sync is there. If you had lip sync otherwise also, that would have overlapped with each other. Agreed. But generally what happens, that if you have a fun song like Galla Gudiya, like that tomato song in the film, there the director doesn't mind the lip sync. But there was a time it was not song and dance. There used to be 12 songs and one song would have a dance, and 11 were serious songs, only song, no dancing at all. And this sense of loneliness, pining, hurt, these emotions were conveyed much better in the song than they could be in dialogue. That has gone out. Why? You tell.
Yeah. Why should I answer?
Because it's your generation. You people have thrown that out.
Yeah, but
now you have Galla Gudiya, but you will not have a Toote Hue Khabon Ne Humko Ye Bataya Hai. That you will not have. And a lip sync of that song. If at all you will have that song, then it will be in the background. Why?
I don't know. It's just changed, I suppose. I mean, even like Tomatina, for me, I couldn't do a lip-sync song because it's a bunch of four Indians in the middle of Spain, and suddenly they can't start singing in Hindi. And everyone's done. It's just silly. So you don't do it. And it's a background song and you buy it. So I don't know why. I think that the pure musical maybe is disappearing. And I think what you're talking about, where the song was part of the emotional narrative of the film, that is not there anymore. But that is pure musical. If you see any of the Hollywood musicals, even today, it's the same thing. They have this, like from West Side Story to Moulin Rouge to whatever you see now, they have this kind of thing. And I think it would be interesting to do, but some people do it. Ayan Mukherjee did it with Ye Jawani Hai Deewani. It was a huge hit, actually.
I'd actually like to add to what the question you asked just now, Javed sir, but it's also touching on something you mentioned in the earlier session. I think it's not just the song and dancing, it's also that there's an increasing aversion to the hyper dramatic moment or what, you know, sometimes gets, you know, we use the word melodrama in a pejorative way, whereas really if you go back to the origin of the word, it's a form of expression, it's a particular form of expression that was associated with, you know, with many art forms and with Hindi cinema of a certain time. Now when I look at the films that you scripted and I look at the films that Zoya's made, similar scenes and similar situations in them. In Trishul, for instance, you have the Amitabh Bachchan character, you know, carrying out this vendetta against the father who had abandoned his mother years earlier, and it's done in this very, you know, there's a lot of dialogue bazi, and I don't mean that in a negative way at all. It's very dramatic and there's a lot of high emotion. And compare that with the scene in Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara, where the Farhan character goes and meets the Nasiruddin Shah character who had left his mother decades earlier. And that's done in such an understated sort of way. You know, he's sitting, rolling the joint, they're just talking to each other. Have we just moved away in some ways from, have you become afraid of sentimentality? New filmmaking?
It's basically, I think what you want, firstly, it's also the pitch of the film. It's the pitch of the entire film, and then you cannot have one scene that goes crazy. Yeah. It has to match the rest of the film. Secondly, in Diwar, Sanjeev Kumar was as much of a lead as Mr. Bachchan. Mm. He was the parallel lead. So the drama between the two of them had to be actualized on both sides. Nasir was there for one scene. He's a reflection of my lead character, which was played by Farhan. Mm. So when he goes in there, he sees, and I did not want to judge that character. I did not want to say he's right or wrong. Which is how I treated the Imran character. Right. He's not right or wrong. This is how he is. And when he meets his father, he's like, I could very easily be this person that's really, that takes people for granted and that is not really apologetic and that could miss out on life.
Right.
You know? And that is his cathartic moment. Yeah. So he's not going to meet his father. He's never met and start screeching at him. Like, it didn't work, you know, in the film. And I think what people don't realize about that scene is actually more than it was the treatment of it, because I don't know if you've noticed, it has no music. It has no background music. So when you take because background music just tells the audience, now you're supposed to be sad, now they are angry, now this is dramatic, now laugh, you know. So when you take that out, the audience is just left and you have two very good actors, right. So you don't really need background music.
Right.
You don't know where the scene is going.
Yeah.
So you don't really know if it's sad or if you should judge him or not. So you just end up feeling whatever you want to feel, which I think is way more powerful than telling an audience what to feel. So I think that treatment of the, because if I add background music to it, it'll become as dramatic.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So it's just how it's treated.
Yeah. Javed Sahab, if I can just throw this out there a little, are you in complete agreement with that, you know, because again, the kinds of the films like Diwar and Trishul, the ones that you scripted back then, did have these, you would always have not just background music, but fairly pronounced background music. It would be tailored at heightening a viewer's emotions and you know, achieving a very specific sort of cathartic effect. Would you agree that today's cinema is, you know, is more sophisticated? And if so, do you also feel that something has been lost along the way?
Well, you see, life offers you packages. Every package has something good and something bad, and you keep wondering which is the better package. As far as the dialogue is concerned, I am, in all honesty, willing to accept that when I look back, I feel that films were slightly dialogue heavy, and they were more literary kind of dialogue. And today, if you see a good film, that film has much more simple language, much more colloquial or real conversation. But what is desirable, and sometimes it is caught and sometimes it is not, sometimes it is achieved, sometimes it is not, is that in spite of the simplicity or real or natural language, you should be able to catch the depth of the emotion. All right, you don't indulge in rhetoric, wonderful. But without doing that, if you can capture the depth of emotion, if you can touch my heart, then it is good enough. And it's easier said than done, but quite often I've seen it has happened, sometimes it doesn't. What I feel that today, the pendulum has gone exactly on the opposite side. Now, I'm not discussing Zoya's film, it's the journal attitude today. You see, films had become their own caricatures by the time they reached 80s. And they were full of cliches. Maa, mujhe samajhne ki koshish karo. Ye mat poochho kya hua, ye poochho kya nahi hua. So, and so on and so forth. And we had a long list of hams, actors and so on and so forth, and cliché dialogue writers. So this generation got a kind of aversion. And they reacted on the other side. Now, anything emotional, anything soft, anything romantic, and they don't want to touch it. Would you notice that in last 10, 12 years, no romantic song, and some very beautiful romantic songs have also been written, have been shot as a romantic song. They put humor in it because they are embarrassed about love. All right, if you are embarrassed about maa mujhe samajhne ki koshish karo, agreeable. But why don't you tell your girlfriend or boyfriend mujhe samajhne ki koshish karo? It's not a bad idea.
Yes, I think that's a very good point there, that there's this, the only way certain ideas can be handled by some of today's younger filmmakers and writers is by doing it with a touch of irony and sort of and becoming a little
hip. No, I mean, yes and no. Like that song which is there right now, Dilwale is, with Shah Rukh and Kajal, Gheru, it's a pure romantic song. And it's done like a romantic song. It's done like a love song. So it's not, there's no absolute. I'm saying that it's in and out.
Okay, yeah,
I'm not seeing Dilwale, so I cannot give any opinion about it. But then Dilwale is again not the representative, without seeing the film I'm saying, of the modern or contemporary film that we are talking about. It is not the day of the release that will decide whether the film is contemporary or not.
Yeah, I think the thing is, when we start talking about the 200 crore films, the really huge Shah Rukh and Salman films that are still very much part of a continuing tradition of commercial Hindi cinema, then perhaps, you know, it's a different matter. I think what I was talking about is more like, you know, most of, you know, the other kinds of films, you know, filmmakers like you, Dibakar, Anurag Kashyap, people who are still fairly big and also working with big production companies in some ways, but who have a different sensibility that has partly come out of watching a lot of world cinema. And like I said at the start, I still feel like your work is the closest that comes to, you know, continuing the old tradition, not being embarrassed about elements of the old tradition, but also, you know, having a cooler, more sophisticated side to it. Whereas many of the other young filmmakers and writers I've spoken to are just sometimes outright dismissive of everything that happened in the past, including things like Sholay and Diwar, which I think is very unfortunate. But if I can just come to another point, Zoya, your last two films, at least in the characters in the films, most of the characters there are people who, you know, in realistic terms would probably be, at least according to me, that English should be their first language, or they'd be speaking more English than Hindi. They'd probably be like us. Yet, of course, you know, it is a primarily Hindi film, and Judge Javed Saab has done the dialogues in many cases. Many of the dialogues are in Hindi. And there are some scenes, just to be candid, there are some scenes where I find it just a little jarring when a Hrithik character in Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara or Anushka in Dil Dhadakne Do says something like, just to give a very small example, ye kya tha, you know, when she'd probably really be saying what happened there, what was that all about or something. Is that something you struggle with sometimes, that, you know, talk about the dialogue?
I do struggle with that. Reema Kakti and me have written both these scripts, and we write our dialogue out in English. So actually, we have a detailed screenplay that can be made into an English film. But we are not making English films. We are making Hindi films. And Farhan has done the dialogue on both these films. My dad has done part of the dialogue on them. And but I use a lot of English. I've been told even what you're saying, I still use a lot of English. And I still need to curb it because it alienates people. Right. You know, and this is my primary audience, so I don't have a choice.
And Javed, somebody can talk. I mean, people don't talk exactly proper grammatical language in their personal life. They may start a sentence with hum and then get into main and so on. They may start with present continuous and then the sentence will turn into past perfect. Whatever. Such things happen. Ye kya tha is also in pabhi kya tha ye. You can say that. Right. It is possible. And as a matter of fact, grammatically also it is right. It is not usual, but it is right. Right.
Okay, so that was just so one.
I think these kind of, shall I say, vulnerabilities of language also make it natural. If the language would be totally perfect, literally perfect, then it may sound artificial also. So I have no problem with this kind of dialogue, in spite of being very, very conscious of what is right and what is wrong in language or poetry. But when people are speaking, you should feel that yes, whatever has been said spontaneously. These were not written words. And if it is achieved, fine.
That was just one example that had come to my mind. I think that more than the specific dialogue, it was just this sense, looking at some of the lead characters in Zoya's last two films, I just felt like they'd, you know, in realistic terms, they'd probably be speaking English a little more frequently than they do within the films themselves. But I take your point about the kind of audience that you need to reach out to. If you can just get come back a bit to women characters. Now, you've mentioned, of course, that the women characters in the films that Javed Saab was scripting in the 70s were strong in their own way. They were independent in many ways. But I think that there's a new dimension that's come in. In your recent films, for instance, if you have something like the romance between Ranveer and Anushka in Dil Dhadakne Do, where she isn't sentimental at all to begin with and starts slowly getting sentimental only when he does, and he's the one who's sort of strutting around and, you know, and wooing her all the time and even doing a dance for her, and then when she feels betrayed by him, she shows him the finger and walks off. Now that is in keeping with a clearly changing, you know, depiction of the female protagonist in Hindi cinema. Could you just tell us your thoughts on that?
It depends, you know. I mean, we've seen it in different ways before. We've seen things treated differently before. But men wooing women, men falling first, I mean, we've seen that before. Woman getting pissed off, woman dumping him, we've seen that before. It's basically the language you do it in. How do you do it and how do you keep it as close to what my experience would be or my friends would be or somebody like her would react to a situation like this. Right. You know, so I mean, if you just stick true to your characters and the story you're telling and where it's set, I think you will come up with something that hasn't been seen before.
Right. I just wanted to touch on one of the themes that is clearly quite close to your heart and, you know, the work that you've done. I know you've said in interviews many times that The Godfather is one of your all-time favorite films, and it's one of the best films you've seen about family, which is such an interesting thing to say, because that's not how those aren't the terms in which most people think of the film. But when you deal with dysfunctional families in your work, most notably in the last film, the sort of the tone of the treatment of the dysfunctional family in Indian cinema has traditionally been, of course, been quite difficult, different from that of, you know, a film like The Godfather, which occupies a different idiom, a more cool Western idiom. How do you reconcile the two things when making a film like Dil Dhadakne Do, in which the children, the younger generation, are constantly pointing out the hypocrisies of the parents and how melodramatic the parents can be?
I mean, there are all kinds of families and there are all kinds of dysfunctional families. In Godfather, they're really tight-knit. I mean, they just happen to be the mafia. So that's what makes it dysfunctional, you know? Yeah. But in Dil Dhadakne Do, what I wanted to do was I wanted to take what people think is really normal and actually show it as dysfunctional.
Right.
You know, because this is not considered dysfunctional. It is considered normal.
Right.
That if your daughter is miserable, it's okay. But it's better than her being divorced. Right. Which to me is bizarre. You know? Or the business should go to the son even if he's inept. Like, I don't understand it. So, I wanted to take what is considered absolutely functional and show that as weird.
Right.
Javed Saab, I just wanted to ask you, you mentioned both in the earlier session and just now that the 80s was, to put it very politely, not a good time for Hindi cinema. You know, all sorts of not very good things happened with Hindi films. Speaking about yourself, since you did some of this really important work in the mid and late 70s, what, according to you, was really changing in, you know, as Hindi cinema entered the early and mid 80s, what changed? Was it simply that the angry young man figure became a caricature of himself, or that it was being done by less accomplished directors or writers?
As I said earlier, that a protagonist is the personification of contemporary morality and aspirations. So we cannot understand the change in cinema or the characters or the hero and heroines without understanding what is happening in the society or what was happening to the society at that time. Look at Devdas. I think Indian literature has not created a bigger icon than Devdas. And this is one novel that has been made into a film more than 11 times in this country. Every language, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayali, Hindi, and of course Bengali, every language has made one version of, or at least in Hindi we have three versions of Devdas. Of K.L. Sehgal, then with Dilip Kumar, then with Shah Rukh Khan. Why Devdas?
And Abhay Deol, Devdi.
Which one?
Abhay Deol.
And Devdi, okay. Now I hope they don't do it again. it should stop now. but so he was the icon. That was the time when the feudalism was taking its last breath. Then, when you were so optimistic about the society, about India, you thought the prosperity of the next page of the calendar, happy days are there, and round the corner, and so on and so forth. So you had, even your rebel star used to rebel only against the parents. There was no sociological issue at all. In spite of having directors like Bimal Roy and Gurudat and so on, they used to make film, but the star, the rebel star, was Shammi Kapoor. Who would tell Lalita Pawar, no, I'm not going to marry this girl. That's all. That was the rebellion. Then, when the image shattered, just before emergency, when you saw for the first time extra-constitutional powers raising their heads, you saw high courts and Supreme Court decisions being rejected, you realize that somewhere the establishment is failing you. So it was totally understandable that a character, a vigilante character like Vijay, would come up and it will be lapped up by people. Then it turned into cynicism. It was impossible in 1950 to show a neta, a villain. It was impossible. Nobody would have accepted it because we had respect for our netas. Then in later 80s, you saw the political leaders and the policemen became villains. For a while, we had Pakistan to fill the gap. But now that is also exhausted. So at the moment, we are at a loss of a villain. What does it mean? It means that we are not very sure what is right and what is wrong. The society. We were in 70s and 60s, things were simple. In 70s, you know, socialistic pattern of society in 50s and 60s was acceptable. So rich people were bad people, poor people were good people. Simple. Now, Kaun Banega Karorpati is one of the most popular programs. So now rich people are not bad people. rich people are my future. So who is bad? We don't know. That is the problem. If you don't know who is bad, then you don't know who is good. And if you don't know who is good, then you can't have a strong hero character. You can't have a strong heroine. There was a time when Machu Prahungi was the ideal heroine. Meena Kumaris and Mala Sinhas of the world were the ideal other Indian women. Now they are rejected. Now we are sitting on the debris of that woman. And we don't know what is right. In that is the film, Yash Chopra's last film. Jab Tak Hai Jaan. Now the heroine has a dialogue in that film. I am not outraged morally at all, but you have to look at it critically. She says, I'll get married after sleeping with one man of every nationality of the world. Now this is false bravado. This is nothing but bravado. You see, we are looking for the emancipated woman. And people who are writing the film, people who are making the film, have no idea who is the emancipated woman. So they are making these kind of outrageous statements. To look for the contemporary Indian woman. Who is a contemporary Indian woman? No writer so far has been able to define that. And it's a pity. It's a shortcoming of the writers and directors that they don't understand that woman. So they think if she is smoking, if she's making outrageous statements, if she's using four-letter words, then she is empowered. So at the moment, we don't have heroes and we don't have heroines, as far as the images are concerned. And perhaps this is also a transition and we'll find our moorings again, and better this time.
I think that's actually a very good note to open this out to questions, since I'm sure there'll be many from all of you. And I think we have how much time? Around 10 minutes? Yeah, do we have mics? No, just wait for the mic.
Mic kahan hai?
We can use your mic for
that. Okay.
We
don't have any mics with us, right?
Okay. Give it to her. She was the first one to start.
Okay. Thank you. This is a question to Zoya. And it's from the discussion, in the sense that the Trishuls of the films like Trishul, in my experience, appealed a film like Trishul. In my experience, appealed equally to someone like me and my driver. Whereas the films that you make or your brother make or that genre of filmmaking seems to me targeted to a part of Indian society. And who empathize with that, and they're wonderful films as films. But the question to you is that, do you feel like making a film that appeals to all of India at the same time?
No, I would love to make a film that appeals pan-India, but I have to make what I want to make and what works for me at that point. A story that's going to hold my interest for two and a half years. I can't make a film thinking this will appeal. I don't know what will appeal. So I've got to make what, and you know, the India of Trishul is not the same as the India of Zindagi. I mean, it's completely changed, you know, so it's not the same audience anymore.
Please, us ladki ko kaho. Naam seemly wali usko wo samne hai, wo dekho, wo piche jao. Now you better ask a good question.
Yeah. I hope I don't disappoint.
One must
a very
know,
good evening.
A very simple question. One, I have been an avid follower of Mr. Javed Akhtar, and very recently I have used his poem Ye Waqt Kya Hai in my theatre. But I have a question with Zoya again, that if she does not know to whom or to which appeal she is making film, this is sad. And you a very simple question, that you have created a character of Trishul, Divar, or all that angry young man. What was the impact on the society of this character? That's
it. Since you were on the receiving end, you can tell that better. Did it make you violent?
Yes, it has created some kind of violence at that period
in you,
of time.
In you?
Even it made me angry.
You became a smuggler?
No, not that.
No?
It's not that. I am asking about a broad...
Why are you treating yourself as an exception? You're the part of the society. And you have loved those films. So we'll analyze you. What was the reaction of these films on you? You tell us.
About the general people.
Are they inferior, superior? What? They are like you, aren't they? You think they are inferior?
No. It had some kind of influence on the people. Some kind of influence on the people.
Let's start from you. Yeah.
Yeah, a very good evening to all the panelists. My question is, the other day I attended a session here by Imtiaz Ali in which the topic was the action hero of the yesteryears has somehow died down in Indian cinema. You know, the action hero does not exist anymore, the angry young man. So we were trying to, you know, bring out points, how do we revive it? So do I see Mr. Javed Akhtar again bringing back an angry young man to Indian cinema?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. As you said very rightly, that with time the society changes, and with time I have also changed. As a matter of fact, I don't think I'll be able to write what I had written 40 years back. I hope I have changed. If I write exactly what I was writing 40 years back, it means I have not progressed at all.
Very true, very true. And what about a woman? I mean, a woman protagonist, you know, a writing in which the woman takes the lead. Because in your films, I have seen women being quality women, but I have not seen a woman leading the role, you know, or, you know, like an angry young man, an angry young woman, maybe.
Yeah,
something
yeah.
like what Kangana played in Queen, a very woman-centric role.
Yeah, I don't know whether I'll be able to do it or not. You can write only what you can. I have lived out of my family on my own from the age of 15. And perhaps I was not exposed to family life, and I never had these kind of experience. My life was with boys and men in hostels and so on. And even in film industry, when I had gone to film industry, I would see women as stars, as playback singers. Few of them were journalists, and that's about all, or perhaps hairdressers. Today, women are directors, women are writers, women are camera persons, they are editors, everywhere. So as a matter of fact, in my formative years, I was not exposed to women to that extent. I have lived with men. So my experience is different. As far as now, I must, on a more serious note, I must, I think, respond to him. You see, there has not been any survey. There has not been any sociological study how cinema reacts or influences people. The fact is, we have around, even now, even less, in 70s, we had around 14,000 theatres. Out of those 14,000 theatres, 8,000 theatres were in Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, and Tamil Nadu. Rest of the six, most of them were on the west coast, in Kerala, in Gujarat, in Maharashtra, and very few, a very decimal number, in UP, Bihar, and other places. Now, if cinema and Northeast and Kashmir, even the least, now let's see where was the violence and where is the violence. So you realize where there are less theaters, there is more violence. So how can we believe that cinema is spreading violence in the society? Where there are more less cinema houses in UP, in Madhya Pradesh, in Northeast, in Kashmir, there are hardly any. Now in Kashmir, in the valley, there are no cinema houses at all, thanks to some mullahs. So, our violence is caste-based, economic-based, and this will be, I'm not trying to defend cinema. I'm telling you that let us not have a wrong diagnosis of a national problem, because then we will not be able to correct it. This is just a fallacy. This is an excuse. In our country, violence is economic-based and caste-based. Actually, caste-based is also economic-based. To think that cinema is spreading violence. Now, there is a lot of immigration in the cities. Now, when you see these kind of grotesque rapes and these things, there are people who are living under the same sky, in the same territory, but they are living in different centuries. They are living in different economic zones. And there is a clash of civilization within our society. Some people are living in 18th century, some in 19th, some in 20th, and some in 21st. So obviously, an exposure through media is so much that I am now much more aware what I am deprived of than what I have. So in this condition, you know, an average Indian boy, till the age of 22, 23, till he's not married, I think beside his sister and mother or aunts, has never spoken to a woman for 5 minutes. The society is still as segregated in smaller towns. Then you bring him to the city, and he see one who had seen women from 100 yards. Now suddenly he sees different kind of women who are affluent, who are free, who are empowered. He hates them. These kind of rapes that you see are not only sexual crimes. That shows the kind of anger is seething underneath in this society. And we blame it to cinema. Everything that is happening, economic deprivation, social deprivation, cannot be blamed to cinema. And this is a whip boy. Cinema is a whip boy. But we have to face the reality. The fact is, it is the society that makes cinema. Cinema doesn't make the society. Otherwise, even today, we would have been making new theater films. Why have we stopped making those kind of films? Society governs. They tell you where to go, and the producer follows that. That's a fact.
Okay, so it's a small question for both of you. Do you think censorship in India is handicapping the creativity in this present scenario? And if it is, do you have a way around it?
I don't believe in censorship at all. I think it's a certification body. I think there has to be a certain amount, it has to be classified. If you show this, this is your rating. If you show this, this is your rating. If you show this, this is your rating. And then, you know, so we need to, and we need to enforce the law. We need to enforce that if it's an adult film, children don't watch that film. They cannot buy a ticket and go in, which happens everywhere in India. You know, and I don't understand parents, because I've sat at in discussions like this where people have gotten up and said, I took my child to see this movie and this happened in this movie. I was like, but you saw the promo, you saw the item song. Why have you taken your child to see it? I mean, it is very democratic. You can buy the ticket or not buy the ticket. You have chosen to run to the theater. So why are you shouting at me for a film I have not made? It doesn't make any sense to me. So you see a thing, you decide if you want to see it, if you want to subscribe to it. And frankly, people are subscribing to it, which is why it's being made again and again.
Sir, ek mera chota sa point hai, wo aap log zarur note kijiye. So often I have heard, भाई आजकल तो आप लोग जैसे फिल्में बनाते हैं वो फैमिली के साथ तो देख नहीं सकते तो मैं पूछता हूँ यू परवर्ट यू कैन सी इट अलोन व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय फैमिली के साथ क्यों नहीं देख तो अकेले देख सकते हो
सर डू यू बिलीव दैट द एंटागनिस्ट डिफाइंस द प्रोटैगनिस्ट Because if the antagonist were not to exist, the protagonist would not have existed. Because the antagonist could be the anti-hero, the villain, or the society at large. So what do you feel about this, sir?
To be honest, I have not understood the question. But I'll try to sound wise. You see, I mean, obviously, you can only have a protagonist if you have the opposite. And the bigger the opposition, the bigger the protagonist. And if you don't have a strong opposition, you can't have a big hero. It's as simple as that.
Sir, my question, not question, but I like to tell you the way you are saying there is no, in today's cinema, there is no projected hero and there is no projected heroine. So maybe earlier we used to consider someone as hero who is doing all the good deeds and the villain doing all the negative things. So can we say it like that, that nowadays we are less judgmental? We are not categorized things into only black and in whites. Things are merging. There are lots of grays to conceptualize. So is it so? Like people and our society is becoming more less judgmental. We are judging less as ourselves and so do other.
You have a very valid point. Maybe it's right, but the fact is it doesn't make very strong stories. Let us be honest. You make strong stories with strong characters. Strong characters have strong commitments, and that's why they are strong. So maybe it's more matured. I totally appreciate your point. But the fact remains that all over the world, the mainstream cinema will have very little gray and black and white. Good cinema will have grays, but gray is not very good box office.
Okay, I'm sorry, we just have time for one last question. We're out of time. Yeah, why don't you just...
How about the mic?
Hi, you were talking about how, you know, nowadays songs reflect what we think today and how it's changed from before and all of that. So, and then you brought up Zoya Dilwale, and the romantic song that comes to mind is Gerua. But wouldn't it be more contemporary today for one hero to sing it for another hero or at least another man or a heroine to sing it for another woman? Isn't that what we need coming in even more today in films?
Well, there was firstly, a song, let me remind you. Bas yahi apraadh main har baar karta hoon, aadmi hoon, aadmi se pyaar karta hoon.
Firstly, we, before it comes into cinema and it comes into that space where we can actually have love songs between people of the same gender, which would be absolutely beautiful, actually. I think we need to get rid of the law. Yeah, for starters. Article 377.
She has a question.
Last question. Last question.
Do you have time?
Last question.
Yeah,
we have
make it quick, but this is the last
very
one.
Quick, very quick. Okay, you've talked about the 70s and the vigilante, and I'm talking about the heroes today, not your heroes necessarily, but you know, this whole concept of patriotism, having a patriotic hero, or having a hero who has some issue in his family, in his backstory, and it has to be made right. So you have films like Dabang, which also have that crucial family story behind. It's not too far away from the stories that you had in the 70s. And then you have a film like Airlift or various other films which are situational, where a hero is coming in a very patriotic construct. So I don't think that we're really cutting away from a tradition of heroism constructed before. There are just new trappings to them. But more necessarily, I think what I'd like to ask is this whole idea of youth and aspirational and everything that's being said over and over again. You have heroes who are touching 50 or crossing 50 who will now still pretend they're college boys and still pretend that they're doing romance. How do you deal with this? I know you write very real stories, but the general audience is still quite clued in about accepting this sort of dissonance.
The general audience is very happy with it. Yeah. So, I mean, no one's complaining.
Now, besides that, we are not discussing actors. Yeah. We are discussing hero images.
Yeah.
You see, angry young man is an image We are not discussing Amitabh Bachchan. In the same way, when we say Devadas, we are not discussing K.L. Sehgal or Dilip Kumar or Shah Rukh Khan or many other actors who have played Devadas. Sumitra has also played Devadas in Bengal, or P.C. Barua had played that. The images, actors will come and go. They will not tell you anything about the society. It is the image that tells you about the society, and that is relevant.
Thank you so much, Javed Saab and Zoya, and thanks. A big hand for them, please.